Nice to be in this park.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And I'd like to welcome you to this press conference this morning, formally marking our exiting the EU IMF programme after 3 years. This morning, the format will be that the ministers will say a few words and then we will take questions from yourselves. As you know, we're facilitating TV media after this press conference, so if we could please concentrate on print and broadcast during this session, that would be very helpful. I'll take the questions in order, so if you could please raise your hand if you'd like to ask a question. And especially as we are joined by our international colleagues this morning, could I ask you to give your name and the name of your media outlet as you're asking your question? And I'll ask the ministers to say a few words now. Thank you.
Michael. Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for being here. We're approaching the third anniversary of the programme of assistance for Ireland. And we've exited the programme successfully now. We had our 12th review, which was the final review. We have completed, I think it's 270 individual actions which we were required to do under the programme, and we have drawn down the remainder of the official finance that was made available to us. I don't think there's much need to go back. The programme was necessary because the previous government and the NTMA at the time couldn't get any funding on the markets, so they had to go to lenders of last resort, which were the IMF and the European authorities. And the lenders of last resort, because they allowed us to make the adjustments over a lengthy period, were very helpful. So what might have to be done overnight was done over 4 years, and you can imagine the shock that that would have caused. Now, the real heroes and heroines of the story are the Irish people. They've had their taxes increased, they've had their services cut drastically. Some of them, particularly public servants, have had very serious pay cuts. Everybody has caps on their pensions and have had pension cuts as well. And yet, you know, they sustained the programme. They continued to support the government while we implemented the programme. This isn't the end of the road. This is a very significant milestone on the road, and it gives us an opportunity to pause and reflect for a very short period. But we must continue with the same types of policies, because the deficit is too high and it has to be brought down below 3%, and then it has to be brought into balance in subsequent years. The debt is too high and we have to have strategies to make the debt even more sustainable than it is now, and I believe it is sustainable at present. But above everything else, we must gear all government policy and the policy of all state agencies. And indeed, we must encourage private sector policy for a dual objective: to grow the economy and create the jobs that this economy needs. And we continue, we've started that. It's 58,000 jobs net were created in a 12-month period. And the growth is expanding across the different sectors now, and there's job creation in all the sectors. But we must continue to reinforce that. And in the simplest of terms, we must take out of the system anything that's inhibiting growth and job creation. And we must put into the system those instruments of policy which encourage growth and job creation. Because when we do that, that's the key to everything. The people who have suffered most in this catastrophe are the people who lost their jobs and their families. The people who have suffered next are those people that were forced out of the country and had to immigrate because of lack of jobs. Now, we want to reverse both trends. We want the people who lost their jobs, want to get them back to work, and we want to encourage our very bright immigrants to come back into the country and contribute to growing the economy in the future. So I'll stop there and hand over to my colleague, Brendan Howlin.
Thanks, Michael. I re-echo what Michael has said. This is it is a milestone on the journey of recovery. I know when we reflect back that when we were negotiating the programme for government, when we were briefed by the main agencies of the state, the NTMA, the Central Bank, the Department of Finance and others at the time, there are many who believed that we would never reach today. And in truth, there have been times along the journey that we had doubts ourselves, because some of the things and some of the challenges even became greater because of the external challenges that came in the Eurozone area over the last number of years. But we have reached this milestone, and we have a much greater control of our own destiny into the future. And that is a huge testament to the fortitude and to the forbearance of the people of Ireland, who rolled up their sleeves and understood that a job of work had to be done to put things right for themselves and for their children. And they weren't happy with that. They weren't happy with the economic collapse that worsened their living conditions, that sent many of them abroad, that lost a quarter of a million of their jobs. But they knew that anger was not a solution, and they needed to follow a path that was sensible and logical and difficult. And they've stuck with the government on that journey to date. And I acknowledge the debt this country owes and the future generations of this country owes to, as I say, the fortitude and forbearance of the Irish people. But our job now is not only to look back. It's much more importantly to look forward. Where are we going from here? And we will shape, certainly, the infrastructure of where we're going to be in the future when we publish the economic strategic plan next week. And into that we will build the component parts, which will be built on a sustainable economic future for this country, with quality public services, with certainty in relation to growth strategies that will maintain Ireland as the best place to do business, as a place that is a good place to live, that has decent quality of wages, and that is a good place to grow old in. And they're, I suppose, the challenges of the future. My job in the last almost 3 years, and my job into the future, is expenditure and reform. The expenditure side, I suppose, is self-evident, that we have to work towards the balanced budget and achieve the targets we set as a government, and that we solemnly agreed with our funders to have a deficit of below 3% of GDP by 2015, and we're well on target to achieve that. We've achieved every milestone along the path of doing that. But the other side of my job is reform, and that is important. And a lot of the reform that has happened in an enormous amount quickly has gone beyond under the radar and has not been acknowledged. But you know, in terms of the political reform, the restoration of freedom of information, which is legislation before the Dáil, the regulation of the charter for whistleblowing, which has been enacted by the Seanad and will be enacted by the Dáil in the next session, the register of lobbyists, to change the culture so that we will be one of the most open democracies and one of the best places for an open type of society. Obviously, the reform in terms of the way we deliver services is running apace, and we will be announcing the next phase of reforms in the public service in January. We've already done that in the education sphere with the establishment of the education and training boards, and it's happened in the local authority sphere, where we have fundamentally restructured how local authorities will deliver services into the future. So we've a lot of work still to do, but I think we can now take the next steps with growing confidence that we have overcome the worst of the challenges facing us, and that we will overcome the remaining ones to be worthy of the confidence that the people and their hard work have given to this government.
If I can open the floor to questions yourself, and could I ask you to give your name and your organisation, please? Thank you.
Noonan and Howlin, Politik in Denmark. You said yourself, Minister, that you are pretty much going to continue the same kind of policies as you've had under the Troika. So how exactly is life going to change for the Irish population on Monday when you're out of the bailout?
Well, it won't change on Monday, except at the level of perception. And the Irish people will know on Monday that the government they elect and the members of Parliament they elect will be making the crucial decisions which affect their lives from Monday on. Unlike the last 3 years, where there was a sharing of responsibility in Ireland, and the Troika had a very strong influence. We will then, when we have control of our own affairs, strengthen our approach, because, as you probably know, we were running almost a parallel programme where we took the economy sector by sector and we increased the growth potential of each sector. For example, what we did with the VAT rates and the tourism sector, bringing it from 15.5 down to 9. That pump primed the sector and it's growing strongly again. We're reinforcing that by abolishing the travel tax. There's a huge future in agri-food and farming. So we brought down stamp duty so that land can be transferred to the next generation of farmers, because we're preparing for the time from 2015 when there are no milk quotas. So there's huge potential in farming. In one finance bill, we brought in 23 different measures of change for financial services. And despite the thousands of redundancies across the banking system, there are more people working in Ireland in financial services today than there were at the top of the boom. So we will continue focusing on the economy sector by sector. But the bottom line on policy is, if it grows the economy, we're for it, and we'll reinforce those policies. If it doesn't grow the economy, we're against it, and we'll change those bits. And then the purpose of growing the economy is to provide jobs for our people. So we'll be in a position to have more control over that set of policies. And of course, as Brendan has pointed out, in the economic strategy framework that we're publishing next week, we'll be providing the framework within which all government departments and government agencies will design their particular growth policies. And we'll be dealing with three elements in the strategy. First of all, the future fiscal management and how we'll approach budgets. So deficits and debts and how we comply with the new arrangements in Europe will all be part of it. The second area will be the provision of credit, because the banks need to do more, but there also has to be credit provided from a non-banking sector. And then there will be very extensive guidelines on future reform, as Minister Howlin has already pointed out. But that will set the framework. Then government departments like agriculture will fit their policies into that, and you'll see a rolling out of sectoral policy for the first 6 months of the new year.
Thank you, Minister. Just have a few, Niamh, if you'd like to take the microphone. Thanks.
Minister Howlin, one for you. Mr. Noonan's already talking about providing tax cuts for people who need them. Where would you like to see the first big area of spending start?
Well, I don't think we're ready to start giving out largesse just yet. But I think in the last number of weeks, both parties in government have made it clear that a lot of additional burden has been placed on hard-working families, additional taxes, additional costs. They've seen property charges come upon them, reductions in child benefit and so on. So certainly, I think both parties in government would like to see some easement on the burden of coping families into the future. But we haven't even scoped out what we need to do, because we're going to be prudent in the decisions we make. The prime focus, as Michael has underscored, is to grow the economy, to ensure that we are growing jobs in a sustainable way, and that the jobs that we do support are sustainable jobs, not bubble jobs, as happened in the past. But within that context, we'd certainly like to see an easement of the burden on hard-working, coping families who've been asked to take a lot of the burdens of the last few years in particular.
Thank you, Minister. Jamie?
I'd like to say something about our position on tax. Even when things were at their worst in the last 3 years, we reduced some taxes. For example, the VAT and the tourist industry. So we see tax as an instrument of economic policy. And the same approach will be followed when we're looking at income tax in the next two budgets. And if we can make changes which helps the economy to grow better and creates extra jobs, those are the kind we will do. And you will have seen in this morning's papers a statement from the IDA, for example, that certain aspects of the income tax code are inhibiting foreign direct investment into the country. So we look at it in its generality. We'll certainly be conscious of the sacrifice that people have made, but we'll be motivated primarily by how tax can be best used as an instrument of economic growth and job creation. And we did that on other taxes, even when we didn't have the resources and had to raise extra tax elsewhere. So we pursue that into the income tax area.
And obviously the issue of equity is important. As we made the decision to take the lowest cohort of people out of the universal social charge on an equity basis, the issue of equity and fairness will underscore any decision we make on taxation.
Thank you, Ministers. Jamie.
Jamie Smith, the Financial Times. Question for Michael Noonan. Was Jean-Claude Trichet being unfair to Ireland back in April 2011 when he opposed your proposal to burden senior bank bondholders? Is your relationship with Draghi better than it was with Trichet? And are you still trying to push for this retrospective recapitalisation of your banks to get some of that bank relief on the debt back? Thanks.
Yeah, the people who designed the euro were the people who still held the significant influential positions when the crisis occurred across the eurozone. And they tended to reaffirm their original decisions, and they were adverse to change. And now, our view always was, in both Labour and Fine Gael, was that we should move to a bail-in model where the assets of the banks were used to get banks out of problems of insolvency, rather than a bailout problem by the taxpayer. Now, Mr. Trichet was insistent that while one could bail in equity and one could bail in junior bondholders, the senior bondholders were untouchable. And we had a contrary view. But obviously, we couldn't act without the assent of the European Central Bank. Now, what has happened is our argument prevailed, and European policy has now changed. And with the negotiations on the banking union, it's quite clear now that bail-in is going to be the way to resolve banks in the future, and that there's a hierarchy of bail-inable assets which will include, in sequence, various types of senior bonds. So that's where the policy argument started, and that's where the policy argument ended up. Now, on the other hand, I thought that Jean-Claude Trichet was a very good central banker. He did an awful lot for establishing the euro as a European currency, and it's a very strong currency again, and it's getting stronger. There is 18 countries in it now. Even though the euro was in crisis, Latvia became a new member of the eurozone, and other European countries are planning to join the common currency area now. But there's no doubt at all that the appointment of Mr. Draghi has given a change of emphasis and a huge fillip to the strengthening the euro. Because as well as having a common currency now, there is a common fiscal policy across Europe, with two PACs, six PATs, executive excessive deficit procedures, stability treaties. All that means that there's a common approach to budgets in the different European countries now. So we have a fiscal union to add to the currency union. And we're well down the road to establishing a banking union. So the way that Frankfurt operates now is different from what it was 3 years ago. And the changes have been quite dramatic.
Just the last part of the question, are you still pushing to get the money back?
The issue on debt is sustainability. And our debt is going to peak this year at something under 124% of GDP. And that's very high. But there are other issues other than the size of the debt which are relevant to sustainability. One is the length of the maturities. And the arrangement we made, for example, on the promissory note means that we effectively have money at 1% on the promissory note, and we don't have to make the first capital repayments until 2037 and the final repayments on 2055. So the market's looking at debt, look at the size of it, but they look at the composition. And they say, there's 30 billion of it in there on the promissory note, which is highly manageable because it spreads so far out at such a low interest rate. The second thing was the length of the maturities. We got the European aspect of the debt, the official debt. We got the maturities extended significantly. So the peaks and the valleys have been evened out. And there's a much smoother repayment path on the debt now. As well as that, there's a peculiarity in the accounting of debt. All those cash buffers we have, the in excess of 20 billion we have, we can't offset that against the debt. That accrues as part of the debt. And we're holding 20 billion means we're holding 2.5 times the 2014 deficit in cash buffers. We're fully funded out into the middle of 2015. But of course, the NTMA will taper those down. And the tapering down of the debt to a point where we'd be holding, say, 18 months of the equivalent of the deficit would bring our debt down from 124 to 114 without any other action being taken. And then the banks, as they trade into profitability, the shares we hold in the banks have a value, and neither party in government is committed to long-term state ownership of banks. We want to restore them to the private sector in due course when the price is right. And again, we'll use the proceeds to reduce the debt. The average European debt is 94% of GDP. So without any retrospective or retroactive recapitalisation of the banks, we think we can get the debt down very, very significantly. And in my view, it's entirely sustainable. As well as that, you know, we're running a structural surplus in 2014 budget. And as soon as you start developing structural surpluses, well, then the trajectory of the debt is downward. So, yes, we're pursuing it, but it's not the only method we have of making the debt more sustainable and taking it down to the European average and then proceeding in accordance with the Stability Treaty on the fractional reduction each year until we get down to 60% of GDP.
Thank you, Mr. Fia Kelly from the Irish Times. Could I ask both ministers, Minister Noonan, you said that from Monday morning the Irish people can know that their parliamentarians and their government are making decisions for them. Do you both feel that it may be slightly more politically tricky to manage expectations within your own party, within a coalition, now that the Troika is gone and the discipline of the Troika, well, not fully gone, is largely gone, and backbenchers may feel there's more room for manoeuvre?
Well, maybe if I have first shot at answering the question. I have said to my own parliamentary party, without any, to use the Irish phrase, plumose, that I feel that the current parliamentary Labour Party, and I think it's probably true of the Fine Gael Party, who obviously I know less well, is the most disciplined and thoughtful parliamentary party that I've worked with in my political career. And we simply wouldn't have been able to get through the last 3 years without that sense of comprehension of exactly what the economic requirements of the state were and what needed to be done. And they've been extraordinarily disciplined and understanding, intelligently comprehending of what was required to be done. So I don't expect that to evaporate overnight. There will be a proper debate, because the debate now that has started is we walked into government with our eyes open in the worst existential crisis to the Irish state in our political lives and beyond, probably the worst since the state itself was founded. We have now worked might and main with the support and forbearance of the Irish people to get us to a better place. So the next question is, what sort of Ireland do we want? What is the next phase of Ireland to look like? I think there's a consensus, certainly across government parties, that we certainly don't want to go back to where we were, a bubble economy. We want to have a different type of society, and that debate will be a lively debate, I think, within both our parties, about the shape of public services, about the equity within society, about what values will characterise the Irish state into the future. So I'm looking forward to the next phase of our development, because what the last 3 years has done is enabled us to start thinking for ourselves now, within the context of our membership of the European Union, the fiscal constraints that are part of fiscal union that Michael has described in some detail, but what sort of society we're going to build in that context.
Thank you, Ministers.
I don't have a lot to add to what Brendan has said. I think we built a very strong consensus in support of the programme, and all opinion polls through the programmes showed that those parties, Labour and Fine Gael, and also Fianna Fáil, who generally supported the programme, had the support of about two-thirds of the electorate. So I think what we need to do now politically is to build a new consensus around a series of objectives. First of all, that this must never be allowed to happen again, and I think we'll get consensus on that. That the primary objectives have to be growing the economy and creating jobs. I think we'll get consensus on that. I think we have to be fair and reasonable with no undue burden on any section, and we must look after the weak and vulnerable. I think we'll get consensus on that when it comes to having the leeway to spend again. So I think the elements of that consensus is there within the two parties, and I don't think we'll have a big difficulty. But we're open to the assistance of the opposition parties as well in building the new consensus. And, of course, we want the wider electorate to buy into it as well. So, you know, we can't go mad again. We don't, and even if we had the resources, which we don't, it would be the wrong way to go. But we need to frame a new political consensus that the public support, and that has not only to be fiscal management and economic management, but it has to have a very strong social content as well. I think you'd agree with that.
Absolutely.
Henry MacDonald from The Guardian. Minister Noonan, one of the weakest sectors of the Irish economy is domestic demand. How, in any way, is exiting the bailout programme this weekend going to change that situation, make people spend more, and end the kind of consumer chill factor that's been around for so many years?
Try and book a restaurant tonight in Dublin.
Yeah, I think, you know, lots of things are happening in parallel. And obviously, there are cause and effects relationships, but other things are happening separately. There's a lot of anecdotal evidence around now, kind of soft data, that the economy has turned and domestic demand is coming back. But I listen to the stories, and you all hear, you know, I had to ring five restaurants before I could get a table. You've all heard those kind of stories in recent months. But the hard data comes through on the tax side. And the hard data from the November tax figures showed that income tax VAT in excess all increased well beyond forecast. And when you think that we didn't increase income tax rates, we didn't change the bans in income tax adversely, we didn't change the credits in income tax adversely in any of the three budgets, and yet year on year income tax went up by nearly 5% on the November figures. So, like, there must be something happening in the economy. There must be demand in the economy. There must be greater activity. VAT has gone up as well, well beyond forecast. Excise has gone up, although excise jumps around a bit, so it's not as good an indicator, but it did go up in November. So my view is that domestic demand is beginning to re-establish. I think one of the factors in the build of confidence is exiting the bailout, but I think another one is the fact that property prices are beginning to rise again. I think that if your only savings really are what you put into your family home, it's a huge shock to confidence if the value of it goes down by 50%. And that's what happened. Now that it's beginning to lift again, I think that's getting confidence back in. Because there is a lot of money around. Savings ratios are very high at the moment. And people, you know, are beginning to spend. If you look at the measures in the budget, we took a lot of measures to encourage people to spend as well. And there's a very large number of inquiries about the tax breaks for improvements to the family home.
And I think you'll see demand in 2014 re-establishing. It's fragile now. It will be easy kind of scare people off again. Any bad international event could stop what's happening. But at present, in my view, things are building. And things are building well. And I would hope that next year will be a better year for all our people who made such sacrifices.
Thank you.
Minister Shane Coleman, News Talk Radio. You've both been very much focusing on the need for economic growth, but in practical terms, how do you achieve that economic growth, and what can you do as a government to push that? And I'm thinking in particular of the largesse, for example, from Bord Gáis. Are you tempted to use that money as a stimulus package? And if you do, how do you ensure the money is spent wisely and doesn't create another bubble, for example, in the construction sector?
Well, one of the things we set out from the beginning when we inherited what we regarded as the bad deal struck by our predecessor government was to incrementally unravel it. And we've done, I think, a fair job of unravelling a lot of it. But on the specific issue that falls within my area, the sale of state assets, we had a view as government that simply taking assets that we might get from the sale of either BGE or other things that we determined we should sell and use it to retire debt wasn't the most urgent requirement of our economy. What our economy required desperately was additional capital. In November of 2011, when I published the revised public capital programme, we, by necessity, had downsized the spend. Now, we were still spending $17 billion over the duration of the plan, which wasn't far from European norms, but was well down on what was available in the 10 years running up to 2011. So we looked for ways to supplement that, because the construction sector, at peak, had become an unsustainable 25% of our economy, but now has shrunk to something of the order of 6%, and the sustainable level would be the order of 11 or 12%. So how do we get capital, since the private sector in this economy weren't investing except for foreign direct investment that we're still building? And one of the means, certainly, was to use state assets for that purpose. As you know, when we sold the lotto license during the course of this year, the sum involved was €405 million. That's to be paid in two payments, and I allocated the first €200 million for construction-specific jobs that needed to be done. The retrofit programme of local authority houses to create jobs across the country, but also to greatly improve the energy sustainability of low-income households. We put €50 million into upgrading the county road system to ensure that rural communities actually had functioning roads to supplement a reduced allocation from the Department of Transport. And we added additional money to the schools building programme, because we have a demographic pressure that needed to be addressed. And in fact, we're building more schools this year than any time in our history. And that spreads construction across the country. The second big chunk of that money, obviously, will be spent on the new National Children's Hospital, hopefully starting next year. And then you asked specifically about BGE. BGE, having a fortnight ago, we made the determination that the shortlisted bidders weren't sufficiently robust for us to make a decision or to support the sale. All three came back with better bids, and now they're within the value thresholds that we had set. And we've recommended the acceptance of the Centrica bid, or the Centrica-led bid. We will have those assets next year. Under the deal we've negotiated, half of them at least will be available to put into productive use in the economy. I would hope to be in a position to allocate that during the course of next year. The balance is more complicated, the other half. It is actually available as a backstop, because one of the things we were concerned about is, in doing PPPs, for example, other countries like Greece were able to use structural monies as a backstop to get bank investment. We had no similar backstop, because we actually expend all our structural monies. And The negotiations we had with the Commission was to allow that to be used as a backstop. So it will leverage more investment as well. So in essence, in the medium term, all of the proceeds will be used for job creation.
Thank you, Minister.
Thanks. Conor Barnes, AFP. Ireland has long been hailed as one of the kind of star pupils of the bailed out Eurozone countries. Would the ministers have any kind of words of advice for their counterparts in those countries as their bailout programmes continue?
No, not particularly. I mean, the way it's shaping up now is that Spain has exited their programme as well, which was very much directed toward their banking sector. There's a lot of confidence that Portugal will exit as well in the course of 2014. Slovenia look as if they'll be able to solve their banking problem without entering a programme because they're accessing funds in the markets to do so. The Greek situation is improving. They're manufacturing more and they're exporting more. They're not quite there yet, but it has stabilised in Greece. And Ireland has exited. So the phase of additional European countries going into programmes and those in programmes being uncertain about their future, that has passed now. And the Eurozone is quite strong again, and it's a currency union with a fiscal union and a banking union underpinning it. So huge changes have taken place while we were focusing on what we had to do here in Ireland. So I wouldn't give advice. I just say the euro is very important. It has led to a lot of prosperity in Europe, and it's worth underpinning and holding on to, and it will lead to further prosperity in the future.
Thank you, Minister.
Minister Colm Kelpie from the Irish Independent. Two questions, if I may. A big bugbear of the Troika has been the Coalition's inability to deal with the so-called sheltered sectors of society, the Legal Services Bill, pushing that through and so on. What are you going to do to make sure that now is pushed through as a priority? Or is it, as some may fear, will it fall by the wayside now that the Troika have taken the pressure off? Secondly, on the issue of the tax cuts, you talk about prudent tax cuts next year, but the Fiscal Advisory Council has said that there's no scope for tax cuts till at least 2015-2016. You haven't taken their advice on the budget adjustment. You didn't take their advice on the precautionary credit line. It looks like you're not going to take their advice on this either. Is there a risk that you may go down the road of repeating mistakes of the past here? Thank you.
Well, maybe deal with your last question first. I mean, the Fiscal Advisory Council is now a statutory advisor to government, but there are a lot of advices available out there. Obviously, we do have regard to what they say, but they are exactly it, an economic advisory group. We make decisions that go beyond simply the economic. We have a social responsibility and a political responsibility, because there's no point in making decisions that can't bring either a majority in the Oireachtas in the first instance, but a majority of the people to be supportive of those decisions. We've always been prudent, I believe, in the decisions we've made, and that has always turned out because in terms of hitting the deficit targets that we've set, we've always not only hit the set target, but exceeded the target. And one of the commitments both Michael and I gave to the very first meeting of the Troika, because there was a fractured relationship between the external funders and Ireland Inc. when we came into government, was we wouldn't make mistakes of the past. We would not overpromise and we would not underdeliver. And I think the 3 years, the 270 individual delivery items have all been testament to that. But there are one or two things that are not yet delivered. Some of them quite complicated, like the reform of the legal profession. The Legal Services Bill is before the House. The Minister for Justice, Alan Shatter, will be publishing next week, the final week of this session, extensive amendments to that bill, which will be taken in committee of the House early in the new year. So that commitment to reform the legal services, to have greater accountability and greater competition, will be delivered. The reform agenda is not a list of things determined by the Troika. The reform agenda now is a fundamental bedrock of the way this government is going to do its business. As I said to you, I will be publishing another set of reforms in the public service in January. The first round of reforms were by necessity focused on saving income, in reforming procurement, in developing shared services and so on. The next round will be about a number of things, among which will be delivering a better service to citizens, using e-government platforms to deliver services and so on. And that we will continue to drive reform in the legal services, in the public services, in any sheltered area of life. Michael has said that's our drive from now on in the next phase, as it has been from the beginning.
I'd like to say something about the Fiscal Advisory Council. I think the Fiscal Advisory Council is very important. And if you look at any analysis that has been done of why the crisis occurred, especially in things like the Wright Report, they talk about the groupthink being a huge problem and people forming consensuses around flawed policies and contrarian vices not being entertained. So you're working in a key government agency or in the central bank or in the regulator's office. You think the thing is going wrong, but the consensus has moved elsewhere and you're not listened to. Now, to deal with that problem, an independent fiscal advisory council was established under law. They don't submit their reports to the government. They publish independently. So it's deliberately designed to allow room and space for other views to be put before the public so that you get a valid debate occurring and that we don't get into this the problem of groupthink around false policies, which was identified as a key. So the main thrust of what the Fiscal Advisory Council say, I think they're absolutely spot on in all their reports, and I think they're doing us a great service. There are individual issues that we don't agree with. You know, they advise that we would not pull back on the collection in the last budget, where we corrected with tax and expenditure increases at $2.5 billion. They wanted us to go slightly over $3 billion. But the way the tax returns have come in, I think there's a lot of weight of evidence to show that we took a good decision there. But it's around the edges and marginal issues. Now, their issue on tax, I don't think there's a contradiction. Because even when we had very little resources, we were prepared to cut certain taxes for economic objectives. I mentioned the VAT, I mentioned the stamp duty on farmland. We totally reformed the approach to research and development as an instrument of policy to bring foreign direct investment in, and we gave extra tax relief there as well, and that was very important. So it's the same model that I'm applying to income tax with what I'm saying. I'm not saying that we have the resources to cut the quantum of tax in Ireland, but what I'm saying is that the incidence on income has to be reduced for economic reasons. And we're in favour, as you know, of broadening the tax base so that the tax doesn't hit incomes. And we have already broadened the tax base by introducing the property tax.
Thank you, Minister.
Phil Aldrich at The Times. There's been a lot of talk of growth being the focus of lifting the country out of its public finance problems. And there's talk about tax cuts. And I just wondered if you believe that you can get to debt sustainability without doing any further fiscal consolidation, or is it inevitable that there is going to have to be years more fiscal consolidation to really get the public finances in a good state?
Yeah, we're committed to further fiscal consolidation. We're committed to getting the deficit below 3% by 2015. And after 2015, then, we're committed to the terms of the various fiscal agreements across the Eurozone. We think that having reached 3% in the years post 2016, that there will be sufficient growth in the economy to take the deficit down and give us a balanced budget situation without further expenditure cuts or further tax increases. But we have mapped out what our objective is, and we published it, and it's, you know, we're aiming to achieve a balanced budget by 2020, and we're committed to that.
And we'll be setting all that out in the economic framework document next week, including social objectives in relation to employment and so on.
And if this lady next, if I could please.
Nina Trentmann from the German newspaper Die Welt. I've got two questions. One is regarding the Ireland's credit rating. You've been saying last week when you were in London at Bloomberg that Mr. Noonan, that Ireland's not junk, and you're hoping for future improvements of the credit rating that Moody's has been giving to Ireland. So what is your current perspective on that? And then the second question, I've been talking to lots of companies here in Ireland who are saying, well, it's important for us that the Eurozone picks up just because we're exporting so much into the Eurozone. What is your perspective on growth chances for Irish companies that are exporting into Europe?
Well, there are three main credit rating agencies that influence sentiment towards Ireland. Two of them have us at investment grade, Moody's haven't. And we would hope that Moody's will look at us again early in the new year. But you never get advance notice of how credit rating agencies may behave. But I think as 2014 goes by, on my perspective of the economy, the tendency will be to upgrade Ireland across the credit ratings rather than to downgrade us or leave us where we are. It's worth noting as well that if you look at the secondary market, we're trading, our 10-year paper is trading at around 350. I think it was last night it was at 347. Now, we couldn't have got money at those low levels of interest rate at the top of the boom when we had a AAA rating. So, you know, ratings are one thing, but the way markets work are a bit different. So we're actually borrowing at a historic low now, and it's below where we got money when we had a AAA rating, so that's very important. On the anecdotal evidence you have from talking to businesses in Ireland, that's true. Our fundamental economic model is export-led growth. And, you know, it sounds like a cliche, but if your customers aren't buying, you can't sell. And it's very important to us that the European economy is strengthened and that there's consumer demand in especially the bigger European economies. Now, Europe has begun to grow again. So far, the growth is fragile. But on the assessment of Europe that we had last week in Brussels at ECOFIN, the opinion of the European Central Bank and the Commission and the IMF was that the growth would be sustained in Europe and would, you know, not go in a great leap forward, but would strengthen over 2014 and into 2015. So if that happens, we're quite happy. The statistics of Ireland for exports, and this is kind of rule of thumb stuff, we export just over 20% to the UK, 20% to the United States, 40% to the rest of Europe outside the UK, and around 20% to the rest of the world. So you can see with that, within that pattern, demand in the European economies is very important to Irish exports. And as our model is export-led growth, it follows that if demand were to decrease in Europe, it would be bad news for Ireland.
You might, of course, be able to help us. In Germany, you have a new government, the new Grand Coalition. It'll be interesting to see if what the new policy platform there will be in terms of stimulating domestic consumption within Germany, which we would encourage.
Thank you, Ministers. I'm just conscious of time, ladies and gentlemen, so we're going to go with Gavin, Juno, then this gentleman here on my left, and then we'll have Akesh Dasgaelge. I don't think we're actually going to get to everyone today, unfortunately.
Thank you, Ministers. Gavin Riley from Today FM. You've mentioned that although we will know that we're sort of in charge of our own affairs, that not a whole lot will change immediately come 9 a.m. on Monday morning, and we are still subject to the excessive deficit procedure for another 2 or 3 years. Beyond that, the fiscal compact requires us to balance the budget by the end of the decade. And then we're still going to have some degree of troika scrutiny until 3/4 of the loans are repaid, which I think is 2034. So what would you say to someone who might be watching or listening to this now and thinking that this is actually just an occasion to mark the fact that 3 years have passed since the agreement, that this isn't an achievement so much as the fact that 3 years have simply lapsed since we signed the deal in the first place?
Well, I first go at that. I mean, the simple fact is that we are, after this year, we will no longer be dependent on one set of lenders to ensure that we have sustainable public services in this country. That set of lenders, the Troika, had very clear, nailed-down conditionality that ran across all public policy here. So from next year, there are constraints that you've mentioned, but are constraints that are normal constraints for every Eurozone country. There will be some additionality in terms of our excessive deficit until we get the deficit down, and Michael has already indicated the strategy to do that. But for the norm of our business, we will be back in the normal markets to fund our projects here that we determine, like any other normal Eurozone country. In terms of oversight generally, obviously the creation now of a fiscal union means that every member of the currency will have the right of oversight of every other member, because it's all our uniform money. So we have as much interest in the fiscal policies in Germany or Greece or Portugal as they have in us. So that oversight will be a permanent feature of life into the future. And I think that level of discipline is important in ensuring that we don't every 20 years revisit another crisis, that we have built-in correction mechanisms to avoid the run-in pattern that created the catastrophe for us from 2010 onwards.
Thank you, Minister. Juno.
Minister Noonan, Juno McEnroe at the Irish Examiner. While Monday will be probably a welcome day exiting the bailout, there's still a lot of pain for people down the way. There's another budget of €2 billion to be removed from the economy. The mortgage crisis is affecting a lot of homeowners, and health cuts are just around the corner with the service plan to be released. Can you or your colleague Brendan Howlin shed light on that service plan at this stage, which will introduce €666 million in cuts and savings? And what would you say to the ordinary person, again, who might not necessarily notice the change in their life when we exit the bailout on Monday?
I would say that everybody owes a debt of gratitude to all those Irish men and women who made such sacrifices to get us out of the greatest crisis that this country has experienced since the famine. And it wasn't easy for anybody. I would say to them as well that the government is committed now that this will never happen again, and we'll take the measures necessary to ensure that it will never happen again. I'd say to them the government is committed as well to creating jobs, getting people back to work, getting our immigrants to come back home so that families can be reunited again. And I would say that there are reasons to be confident that we can do this, because we're already creating about 1,200 net jobs a week, and that trend, as far as we can foresee, is going to continue. On the mortgages, I would say that we're very nearly at tipping point. Almost 50,000 mortgages have now been reconstructed by the banks, and the sustainability rate is running at 75 to 80%, according to the central bank audits that are taking place. I'll ask Minister Howlin to deal with the health budget.
We will have obviously the health service plan published when the Minister of Health is happy with it and signs off on it. Every area of public expenditure has been under strain. There's no doubt about that. You can't downsize public expenditure in the way we've done over the last number of years without impacting on particularly the big spending areas. And we, in this economy, as you know, between social protection, health and education, those three areas spend 80% of all current expenditure, which is an enormous, obviously, quantum, and you can't make adjustments without impacting upon them. And at the same time, obviously, the demands have never been greater. So we have now between 41 and 42% of the population in receipt of medical cards. 1.9 million people, the biggest we've ever had with free access to health services. But I want to just pick up the point, and it can cause some confusion, because people talk about health cuts, and then you fix a nice demonic figure like 666 to be the health cuts for next year. You see, other departments wouldn't classify those as cuts. That 666 figure, if you break it down, includes, for example, the full year impact of measures already taken. So the partial impact in 2013, there'll be an additional nearly 100 million of the 666 from the full year impact of that. It counts the impact of a full year of the FEMPI cuts, the reduction in income to pharmacists and so on that were implicit in the FEMPI legislation. It includes the additionality of charges for prescriptions and so on that we introduced in the budget. It includes the Haddington Road savings that every single department and agency of state is required to carry. But most of them don't categorise it as service cuts. That's the way that it's presented in the media by some. So there are other pressures in terms of new services that the Department of Health want to bring on stream. Some of them, for example, in the maternity support services on foot of the Savita Halappanavar report. All of these things have to be addressed in the complexity that is the health services here. As we deliver a different type of health service, that we move towards the development of primary care, and we've signed off, as you know, on a range of primary care centres, many of which are now under construction, so that we take the pressure off the acute hospitals and deliver more and more services through primary care centres. So I will look with great interest to the service plan as it's delivered, and it is a whole of government enterprise to ensure that we reform the way health services are delivered and to ensure that we have a quality health service for the people of Ireland.
Thank you, Minister. This gentleman. Sorry, Mary, just behind you in the blue. Yeah, please. Just this man behind you. Thank you.
Two questions, actually. Excuse me. My name is Rainer Kiebert. I'm from the Brand 1 business magazine in Germany. Question one for both ministers. When we looked at the kind of riots that were happening in Greece and in Spain, nothing of that sort was happening here in Ireland. What do you see as the main reasons for that not happening? And the second question only to Minister Howlin. Angela Merkel offered that the German bank KfW would help out Ireland with credits for small businesses. How far are we with that?
Well, if I take the first question in relation to the riots or the lack of, I think we had our own democratic revolution in the early part of 2011, when the party that was in government for the bulk of the last 40 years here was not only put out of office, but fairly much devastated. And its sister party in government at the time was completely obliterated. So people had their venting, they had their riot, and they did it in the democracy of the polling booth. And that's not a lesson lost on any of us. We have to obviously bring the people with us in the journey that we have to embark upon. But it is an extraordinary, it is to the extraordinary credit of the Irish people that they weren't beguiled by, you know, the fanciful economics of make it go away, or if you stick your head in the sand that it'll be all right, or that there's some magic formula. Maybe we're just used to a lot of difficulties in this state always, but we realised that this real crisis would bring us down if we didn't address it, and we had to do hard things on that route. Now, there was many commentaries in relation to that, but the bulk of the people, as Michael has said, weren't happy with what needed to be done, weren't happy with some of the decisions that were made by the predecessor government. For example, socialising the debt of bad banks, which I hear now even Olly Wren has indicated wasn't a great idea at the time. But understood the reality of the situation that had to be faced and were determined to do it. I allow Michael to talk about the KfW Bank, which the banking side is more his area.
Well, we were very pleased when Chancellor Merkel informed our Taoiseach that the resources of KfW could be used to ensure that credit which was required would flow to the Irish business sector, particularly SMEs and middle companies. Since then, my officials went to Berlin to talk to the Treasury, and last week they were in Berlin again speaking to KfW. And there's a delegation from KfW coming to Dublin next week.
Wednesday.
So the talks are going on to decide the scope of what might happen, and then to discuss practical arrangements of how the commitment could be put into practice. So that's the present state of play. It's something, I think, which will mature next year. But we want to get it right. We don't want to rush into it.
Thank you, Minister.
Edward Jarrett, Cash, that's where you get from there. Ronan O'Donnell and Shaw, Aaron Noonan, Asnocht, RTE, as TG Carr. And for the benefit of my international colleagues, this is just a question similar to Jamie Smith's about retrospective bank recapitalisation. On the Kesha Tagama era, Ervalach, Vrame Odochus Kainsin is Luja Grutu Bugon, E. Dochusoch, Gamai, Droch, Iacha, Starula, Namank, Grafazer, Shinaglana, Nugafazer, Frisch of Egan at all. The nation, William Cart Fishin, no, will to Fairfans or Keshnis Latin and Nashin in the Omlana?
Well, filed Shirk, Rielica on ESM, the couple of shot in the news, Agus, Insna Rielica Shin, Ta on Aimon Agusum, on Scopan, Con Capital Heolish Dak Insna Bank, Insna Bank in Aaron. Agus be me the kind to mark and show free shen con allamark conus is feather is in the end of acta batanelli wing freshen fuin the fear creator again a islu agus be me take deal all le shin sibling and shakoing.
Okay, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.